You may have heard about the Battle of Arnhem, or you may have seen the film A Bridge Too Far. You may think you know what happened and what went wrong. Think again. In this series, we're going to look at as much as Operation Market Garden as we can, even the bits other documentaries leave out. We will dispel the myths that surround this operation and find out who exactly was to blame for its failure. In the coming videos, we'll be covering the entire operation, which was not only the biggest airborne assault of all time, but was also the last major defeat for the British military. It remains a controversial operation. Somehow, an all but defeated German army clawed their way to victory, stopping the Allies from crossing the Rhine and winning the war by Christmas. Today we're going to focus on the plan, since it's a plan that's been deemed rotten and badly executed. But was it really that bad of a plan? The situation by late 1944 for the Germans was desperate. Nazi Germany had conquered most of Europe in the early days of World War II, but by 1944 was on the back foot. The Wehrmacht, or German army, was decisively beaten in the east by the Soviets at battles like Stalingrad and Kursk, and annihilated during Operation Bagration. In the south, the Allies had defeated the Germans in the desert and were slowly working their way up the Italian peninsula. And in the west, the Allies had landed in Normandy and had crushed the Germans at the Falaise pocket. They'd liberated Paris and were now on their way towards Germany. It seemed to most Allied commanders that the German army was thoroughly beaten, that the Third Reich was about to fall, and it was just a question of time. Since Normandy, Supreme Allied Commander of the Allied Expeditionary Force, Eisenhower, had been in charge. Knowing that the Germans were thinned out after Falaise, Eisenhower preferred a broad front strategy, that is, by marching his armies forward on all fronts, so that the Germans would have to spread out their weakened forces and would be overwhelmed by sheer weight of numbers. But supply and logistical issues soon became a problem. Armies require supplies and fuel if they are to keep on advancing, and the Allied logistics couldn't keep up with the demand of supplying all the armies at the same time. The result was that Allied armies stopped dead in their tracks in late August and early September 1944. This gave British Field Marshal Montgomery the chance he'd been waiting for. Monty, experienced in the African desert and commander of the Allied forces in the initial stages of the Normandy landings, believed that he had a plan that could knock out the Germans with a decisive blow if he was given logistical priority. In his mind, the British could bypass the German Siegfried Line, cross the Rhine River in September, then race off into Germany's industrial heartland, the Ruhr. He believed he could win the war by Christmas. Facing logistical issues and knowing that the fighting would be hard going through the Siegfried Line, Eisenhower gave the green light, and Operation Market Garden was born. Monty's plan was to drive 30 Corps, a British tank and mobile infantry force, over the bridges of the Lower Rhine River and thrust deep into Germany. That was the garden part of the plan, but of course bridges would be no use if the Germans had a chance to destroy them, so the bridges had to be secure for the tanks in advance, and there were several bridges in the area to capture intact if this operation was to have any chance of success. Therefore, 3.5 airborne divisions, a total of 33,971 men, would land on day one behind enemy lines to secure the bridges and the road to Arnhem. The American 101st Airborne would land at Eindhoven, the 82nd Airborne would land at Nijmegen, and the British 1st Airborne Division, supported by the Polish 1st Independent Airborne Brigade, would land at Arnhem. This was the market part of the plan. With a carpet of airborne troops to secure the route, 30 Corps would simply drive across the secure bridges and ride off into victory. But the bridges had to be secure. Without them, the plan would fail. They were the priority of this operation. So this was two operations in one, Operation Market and Operation Garden, and together they made Operation Market Garden. It sounds simple, and it is until you realise that there's another element to the plan not often mentioned. Once the British tanks were over the Rhine at Arnhem, another division, the 52nd Lowland Infantry Division, would be flown in by air on the fifth day after Drieland Airfield had been captured. Yes, this wasn't an operation aimed at capturing Arnhem Bridge, it went beyond that. The tanks were meant to get to Zuiderzee, which is the shallow bay that juts into the Netherlands. Now, the reason that you don't hear about this part of the operation much is because, spoiler alert, it didn't happen. But this was the true goal of Operation Market Garden. In charge of the airborne part of the plan was Lieutenant General Sir Arthur Montague Boy Browning. This was the father of the British airborne forces, and was the one who said, "I think we might be going a bridge too far." Well, he may have said that, nobody really knows. But he had the task of making Operation Market a success, and that wasn't going to be easy. Troops landing behind enemy lines sounds great until you consider two things. Paratroopers rely on the element of surprise to disorientate and confuse the enemy, so that they can secure their objectives before the enemy knows what's happening. So if surprise is lost or they fail to act quickly enough, they lose their biggest asset, and they're weak. They drop behind enemy lines, are lightly armoured and supplied from the air, so if they're not relieved in a matter of days, there's a good chance they'll be overwhelmed. Speed is therefore imperative. The paratroopers have to take their objectives quickly, and the tanks have to relieve them quickly, so it's worth bearing this in mind when you consider that cracks began to appear in the plan right from the beginning. For starters, Operation Garden wasn't going to be easy. Commanded by Sir Brian Horrocks, 30 Corps would have one road to drive up. One road. An entire corps, one road. That's a logistical nightmare. But considering the enemy could easily counterattack from the sides and cut the road at any point, plus they had to drive 60 miles just to reach Arnhem. I hope you can see the problem here. Even if things went smoothly, it would take at least 2 to 3 days for 30 Corps to get to the British at Arnhem. That's assuming all the bridges would be intact. If the Germans managed to hold or destroy a bridge or two, it could take even longer. The issue of delay is compounded when you realise there weren't enough transport planes to deliver all three and a bit airborne divisions at the same time. This would mean that they would have to be dropped over a period of 3 days, because the RAF also refused to fly in more than one lift per day for fear of exhausting their pilots. Apart from the fact that this would weaken the strength of the initial landings and compromise the paratroopers' element of surprise, it also meant, potentially, not all the bridges would be secured on the first day. If some of the bridges aren't taken and 30 Corps is delayed, the operation fails and the British at Arnhem are doomed. General Gavin of the 82nd Airborne, who was dropping in at Nijmegen, decided that he simply didn't have enough troops on the first day to take all of his objectives. He wanted to take the bridges from both ends at once, but without enough troops on the ground, this task was impossible. He also feared an attack from the Reichswald, a forest that was within the borders of Germany, and he believed that there were a lot of Germans in there ready to counterattack. In his mind, he would have to pull forces away to capture the heights at Grusbeek in order to secure his position against the Reichswald, rather than send troops to take the Nijmegen Bridge. This meant they wouldn't be able to start their attack on the Nijmegen Bridge until later in the day, or until reinforcements arrived on the second day. The element of surprise would be lost, and it was likely that the Germans would have time to react, dig in, and prepare their defences at the Nijmegen Bridge. Not good. To make matters worse, the 101st Airborne had to take 5 bridges on the first day. 5! Led by Maxwell D. Taylor, the 101st would drop as close to the bridges as they could to take them as quickly as possible. This would give them the best chance of taking the bridges, but with 5 to take, chances are they wouldn't take them all. This and the problems at Nijmegen and the lack of transport meant that there was a big chance there was going to be a delay in reaching Arnhem. At first glance, however, the British 1st Airborne at Arnhem seemed to have the least amount of trouble. They only had one bridge to take, well, two, but one main one. Yet it wasn't as simple as that. The RAF refused to drop the paratroopers anywhere near the bridge because of the fear of anti-aircraft cover over Arnhem. And because the ground south of Arnhem Bridge was believed to be too marshy for a landing, although good enough for the Polish coming a few days later, they weren't allowed to land there either. Major General Roy Urquhart was the commander of the British 1st Airborne Division. Urquhart had never commanded paratroopers before, and believed that once he had hit the ground, it was basically going to be the same as any other infantry battle. No. Paratroopers need to get to their objective quickly and sit tight for relief. Essentially, once you've taken your objectives, you're no longer attacking, you're just defending. So perhaps Urquhart was the wrong man for the job? Either way, due to pressure from the RAF and the US Air Force, Urquhart was forced to land 8 to 13 miles from the bridge. Yes, 8 to 13 miles away. Not only was there a real chance that the vital element of surprise would be lost, but also the British paras landing on day 1 would need to hold the landing zones for subsequent waves of paratroopers, meaning there was only a portion of the British paras landing on day 1 that would actually strike towards Arnhem Bridge. And the British would have to hold a huge area, which they struggled to hold with the entire division. To be fair to Urquhart, he did request the troops to be landed nearer to the bridge, such as south as Arnhem, which was again good enough for the Polish brigade coming later, but not for anyone else, apparently. Unknown to Urquhart, during the early planning stage, when briefed a few days before the battle, officers of the 1st Parachute Battalion actually volunteered to land on the town of Arnhem itself, rather than land so far away from the bridge. But in the end, Air Vice Marshal Hollinghurst refused Urquhart's request, and the landing zones remained many miles from Arnhem. It was purely about the anti-aircraft fire, the RAF and the US Air Force thought they'd take excessive losses if they landed near the city. Urquhart's taken the blame over the years for the fact that the landings were so far away from the bridge. In reality, that decision wasn't really his. It's often been argued that Urquhart should have insisted on closer landing zones, but the fact that remains, it didn't happen. The British would land 8 to 13 miles away from the bridge. Of course, the British could rely on the 1st Independent Polish Parachute Brigade landing as reinforcements, who would hopefully arrive on day 3. Yes, it was no surprise that General Sosabowski, commander of the Polish Brigade, had his misgivings about this and the previous proposed operation, Operation Comet, which was basically similar to this one, but with less troops. You see, the airborne units had been told to prepare for battle time and time again over the last few months, only to have plans cancelled at the last minute. This not only affected morale, it gave the commanders an eagerness to get into battle, which may have clouded their judgement during the planning of Operation Market Garden. General Sosabowski was more accepting of the Market Garden plan because it was, well, better than the previous one, although it clearly wasn't perfect either. His Polish brigade would land south of Arnhem on day 3, when the element of surprise was lost days before. It was bad enough for the brigades landing on day 2, but the eagerness to get into battle felt by all the officers and troops is perhaps why the operation went ahead anyway. And it's also why vital intelligence reports about the existence of German tanks in the area were completely ignored. Now, tanks could easily overwhelm the lightly armed paratroopers and threaten the entire operation. Although a lot of the German units in the Arnhem area were of doubtful combat quality, they did have two rather depleted SS Panzer divisions in the area, the 9th and 10th SS Panzer divisions to be exact. Why were these intelligence reports dismissed? I guess we should ask Lieutenant General Frederick Browning, the man in charge of the whole airborne operation. He didn't want to cancel the plans for the mission, with only 2 days remaining before it began. Browning also believed that the Germans were already defeated, and that these tanks were probably just so few in number or would be slow to react. So he didn't warn Urquhart or any of the British paratroopers of the possibility of there being two SS Panzer divisions in the area, which meant that they didn't take as many anti-tank weapons or ammunition as they could have done. Oh, and Browning decided that his corps headquarters would be airlifted into Nijmegen on day 1, using a staggering 38 aircraft and extra gliders on top of that, all of which were taken from the British allocation of transport aircraft. And they were already starved of transport aircraft, as priority had been given to the Americans. Oh, and the decision was taken not to support the air transports or the paratroopers on the ground with ground attack aircraft. This meant that the Germans would be able to move freely in the daylight without fear of being attacked from the air, something they hadn't even been able to do in Normandy. The Germans could reinforce their troops as and when they liked, a fact that was going to be disastrous in the current battle. Despite having two understrength SS Panzer divisions in the area, overall the Germans facing Operation Market Garden were quite weak and were forced to kind of fill the front with ragtag units, including units like the Eyes and Ears battalions, who consisted of men who had disabilities that had prevented them from fighting until now. By this point in the war, Germany was scraping the bottom of the manpower barrel. However, they were well led. Field Marshal Model, Commander-in-Chief of Army Group B, coincidentally had his headquarters in the Hartenstein Hotel, which was near to the British landing zones. He was an experienced leader, having earned nicknames such as Master of Defence, Lion of Defence, the Saviour of the Eastern Front, and the Führer's Fireman, because he constantly puts out fires and plugging holes in the front lines. In defensive battles, he's great, so in this defensive battle, he's the right man for the job. As was Kurt Student, commander of the 1st Volksjäger Army. Volksjäger were German paratroopers, and in the days prior to the Allied airborne assault, Student had been ordered to collect all available units together and build a new front, and this he had done. And these units weren't all elite paratroopers, but it's important to note that Student was an experienced leader and had directed some of the first opposed paratrooper landings in history. You have to remember that paratrooper operations had only really begun in 1940, so it remained a new concept even by 1944. Lessons were still needed to be learnt about how to use the paratroopers properly in combat, but it was the Germans who had pioneered their early use. In charge of 2nd SS Panzer Corps was Wilhelm Beatricht. Hamel was in command of 10th SS Panzer Division, and Harzer was in command of the 9th. All of them were experienced commanders who'd proven themselves in previous campaigns, including in Normandy, in operations like Epsom and Goodwood. good commanders commanding ad hoc forces is what the British and Americans were facing. However, it's worth noting that although the two SS Panzer divisions together maybe had 7,000 men at the most, about 30% of what they should have been, the entire 2nd SS Panzer Corps had spent a good 15 months performing anti-paratroop landing training, and these training exercises were fresh in their minds. Essentially, the paratroopers were landing against an enemy who knew how to deal with them. So this is where we are on the eve of battle. 3 landing zones, 1 road, and an unestimated enemy. The plan has potential to end the war by Christmas, but it isn't flawless. I'll leave you with a question. How rotten was this plan? And do you think it was doomed to fail from the start? Comment below and let me know. Next time we'll see what happens on day 1, so don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't done so already. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing, bye for now. The largest airborne operation in history begins on a Sunday, September 17, 1944. The first Allied paratroopers and gliders descend in Holland in the early afternoon. Thousands of men land as many as 60 miles behind enemy lines, and despite the fact that the battle ahead would last 9 days, it was in the first vital hours of the operation that the outcome of the whole battle and the lives of thousands of soldiers and civilians on both sides would be decided. Last time, we saw how the Allied battle plan wasn't without its flaws, and how the Germans weren't as ill-prepared as the Allied generals believed. And as the battle begins, the question we have to ask ourselves is, did the Allies make efficient use of the first vital hours of the operation? It's the middle of the day, and there's plenty of light, and despite a few accidents, no serious casualties are sustained on the drop. The element of surprise works in the Allies' favour. Taking advantage of the German confusion, most of the Allied objectives are taken quickly within a few hours. Most. The American 101st Airborne Division lands north of Eindhoven and secures most of its target bridges. But as the 2nd Battalion of the 506th Regiment, which included Easy Company from the Band of Brothers series, approached the bridge at Sonn, an 88 and nearby German sentries managed to delay the paratroopers long enough to blow the bridge. The Americans were just 50 metres from the bridge when it blew up in their faces. The 502nd Regiment fought their way through to the bridge at best, which the Germans also managed to blow before it fell into American hands. So the 101st failed to capture a bridge on the canal at the southern end of their sector. 30 Corps can't cross a canal without a bridge, so when they eventually arrive, there's going to be delays while they build another one. And if that wasn't bad enough, a glider from the 101st Airborne crashed near Studenz headquarters, and plans for the entire operation, Operation Market Garden, were in Studenz hands by around 3 p.m. of the same day, day 1. But the 101st weren't the only ones having trouble. The 82nd, landing near Nijmegen, did secure the heights at Grusby, the Hooming Bridge and the bridge at Grave. Browning had also flown in and now set up his headquarters on the Grusbeek Heights. I'm mentioning that because Gavin and Browning had both decided that the Grusbeek Heights were the priority for the operation and had to be taken. And they were taken, because there were literally no Germans there. As a result, a good portion of the 82nd Airborne were just sat on the Grusbeek Heights, shelling the nearby woods, the Reichswald, because a sizeable German counter-attacking force was believed to be in there. Time was ticking down to take what was the real priority, the road bridge at Nijmegen. Now, the 1st Battalion, commanded by Lieutenant Shields Warren, had been ordered to take the Nijmegen bridge that day. However, Warren was first ordered to secure some of the suburbs in Nijmegen and prepare them for the defence, which took him most of the day. So early on, things weren't looking so good at Nijmegen either. If the 82nd failed to take the Nijmegen bridge, there's no way 30 Corps can build a bridge over the wall. Nijmegen Bridge has to be taken, but it isn't. At Arnhem, the British land in fields surrounded by woods. This works in their favour, as it prevented the Germans seeing exactly what the British were up to. But it also didn't work in their favour, as they were 8 to 13 miles away from their main objective, Arnhem Bridge. But General Urquhart had prepared for this, knowing that it would take several hours to fight their way through several miles of enemy-held territory. He decided to send 1st Airborne's reconnaissance squadron, supplied with jeeps, ahead. The idea was to send the jeeps to the Arnhem Road Bridge in a coup de main or surprise attack, then wait for reinforcements from the rest of the division to arrive. Neither trained to use them, nor were they meant to be used for anything other than reconnaissance, this lightly armed and unarmoured force wouldn't last long in a major firefight, but it might be able to slip behind enemy lines and may be able to get to the bridge quickly. However, Sepp Kraft's SS Training Replacement Battalion was one of the closest units to the British landing zones, and seeing that the paratroopers were landing, he decided to quickly form a blocking line near Wolfhayes and to scout out the British positions to gain vital information. Because observation was obscured by the trees, Kraft wasn't sure what the British were trying to achieve, but his line would cause the British some problems in those first vital hours. It was the northern end of this blocking line that the British reconnaissance squadron drove into, barely minutes after the line had been formed. A small force of jeeps was stopped by heavy machine gun fire and even a flamethrower attack. They then tried to advance by foot, but they were driven back, and so the first attack towards Arnhem had failed. Fitch's 3rd Battalion marched along the Ultrasweg, south of most of Kraft's positions towards Arnhem. Unfortunately for Fitch, General Urquhart accompanied the battalion and basically slowed things down. Lieutenant Clemenson's platoon took out a German car, this one, and it was only after the war that they found out that it was General Friedrich Kussen, Arnhem's commandant, who had only just finished briefing Kraft on the situation. Despite this success, 3rd Battalion got embroiled in fighting Kraft's battalion, including an incident where General Urquhart himself was shot at by machine guns and mortar fire. Dobie's 1st Battalion was to take the route that started along the Ede-Arnhem Railway, but hearing reports of tanks ahead, Dobie chose to circle north of the route instead. This had the benefit of bypassing Kraft's blocking line, but he soon became caught in fighting in the wooded areas north of Wolfhayes. The German unit here was a hastily formed Kampfgruppe or battle group, which we will explain later, named after its commander, Weber. Consisting of 90 or so Luftwaffe signalers, and despite being poorly armed and inexperienced, they attacked the Paras as best they could, and although they didn't do a lot of damage, they did cause a delay. To the south, Lieutenant Colonel John Frost's 2nd Battalion had been given the dual task of taking the Arnhem Rail Bridge and the main objective, the road bridge. Frost's men got into combat almost immediately, destroying a small column of vehicles, probably a reconnaissance company from Kraft's battalion, but was quick to get going towards the bridges, bypassing the important Hevendorp ferry, which, although capable of transporting troops across the Rhine, was overlooked in the initial planning. They reached Oosterbeek by 6 p.m. and overwhelmed the token German resistance there. Detaching Lieutenant Barry's 9th Platoon, supported by the 8th Platoon, with orders to take the rail bridge, Barry led a section of 9 men onto the north end of the bridge itself. He thought he could take the entire bridge, but as he got to the centre of the bridge, above the water, the bridge exploded. Luckily, none of his men were killed by the explosion, but the rail bridge was destroyed. No matter, this wasn't the main objective. The main objective was the Arnhem Road Bridge. Now, it had taken 3 hours for 2 Power to get to this point. The German guards at the rail bridge had had plenty of time to prepare their explosives, so the chances of the road bridge being there when they got to it, they had to go on. Shortly before the destruction of the rail bridge, however, Field Marshal Model, German commander of Army Group B, fled his headquarters at the Hartenstein Hotel for fear of being captured. Interestingly, it's claimed that Model wrongly came to the conclusion that the British landed in Holland purely to capture him. There is no evidence of that, but it is true that he fled the hotel, and having assessed the situation at 17:30 hours, he and the staff of 2nd SS Panzer Corps issued the first and perhaps most important order to the German units in the Arnhem and Nijmegen areas. Immediate counterattacks were to take place, and 9th SS Panzer Division to concentrate against the British at Arnhem, and the 10th SS Panzer Division was to drive to Nijmegen, secure the bridges there, and prevent any relief from getting to the British at Arnhem. At the same time, Student's 1st Fallschirmjäger Army was to combat 30 Corps' advance in the Eindhoven area. This was a significant order. The Germans had decided to halt the relieving forces at Nijmegen. If they did that, the British at Arnhem would be trapped miles behind enemy lines and doomed. At 1800 hours, Kraft suspected that he'd been outflanked. He had. Fearing the possibility of encirclement, he withdrew his force, which in turn allowed elements of 3rd Battalion to continue towards the bridge. Having delayed 3rd Para, Kraft's force retreated to the Dreiensweg and helped reinforce a new battle group that had been hastily set up there, Kampfgruppe Spindler. The Germans were practicing a new type of unit organisation called Kampfgruppen. This was an ad hoc formation which could be created or disbanded depending on circumstances. It's basically a makeshift unit which is usually cobbled together with bits from other units and then given a leader and a task. Experienced and decorated in both the Iron Cross and the German Cross in gold, SS Lieutenant Colonel Spindler, commander of the 9th SS Panzer Division's artillery regiment, pulled in as many units under his command as possible. Even units without guns, but he managed by the evening of the 17th to assemble a force of infantry, half-tracks and self-propelled guns, and possibly even some tank destroyers and Mark IV tanks. He decided, perhaps of his own initiative, to form a blocking line to prevent the British from getting to the centre of Arnhem. Spindler is a very significant figure in this operation, who we will see again and again as the battle progresses. Frost and 2nd Battalion were lucky enough to bypass Spindler's line before it solidified. Following the bend of the Rhine, and despite having to detach a company to deal with the machine guns at Den Brink, 2nd Battalion marched into Arnhem. As they moved through the streets, German vehicles screeched across Arnhem Road Bridge, heading south. Commanded by SS Captain Victor Graebner, the 9th SS Reconnaissance Battalion headed towards Nijmegen. Victor Graebner was another significant figure at Arnhem, and we'll return to him again next time. The point is that only a handful of guards were guarding Arnhem Bridge. Frost reached the bridge at about 8 o'clock, following shortly by 1st Brigade Headquarters. They had covered 7 or 8 miles in about 5 hours. The bridge guards were in a pillbox on the bridge itself, so 2 Power dug into positions beneath the bridge and waited for 3rd Battalion and the Reconnaissance Squadron, which ominously hadn't arrived. That's because, facing Kampfgruppe Spindler's determined defensive line, 3rd Battalion had decided to dig in near Oosterbeek, and no further progress was made that evening. Only C Company, which had gone north of Kraft's position, managed to fight their way to the bridge after a violent clash in Arnhem itself, resulting in only 40 or 45 men from reaching Frost's position. 1st Battalion's commander, Dobby, received word via radio that 2nd Battalion had reached the bridge and needed reinforcements. He decided to abandon the idea of fighting to reach the northern end of Arnhem and just get to the bridge. He turned south and fought throughout the night, losing over 100 men, and only got halfway to their objective before, well, they were stopped by Kampfgruppe Spindler. Spindler had stopped 2 of the 3 battalions from getting to Arnhem Road Bridge on day 1, and his achievement is even more admirable when you consider that his force hadn't existed that morning. By the evening of the 17th, another Kampfgruppe named Harder, after its commander, who was, to slightly complicate things, was under the command of Spindler, moved into western Arnhem and cut Frost's troops off from the rest of 1st Airborne. There was now no way that any other British paratroopers would get into Arnhem that evening. In all, around 750 men reached the road bridge in Arnhem, almost all of 2nd Battalion, a 45-man unit from 3rd Battalion, Brigade Head HQ, as well as a few more men from other smaller units, and yeah, they'd made it. They were now surrounded, and they had only limited stocks of food and ammunition. They'd gone unnoticed by the 20 or so Germans manning the pillbox on the bridge, and a couple of attempts to knock it out had failed. A 6-pounder and a flamethrower were brought up and took it out. Missing the bunker, the flamethrower actually hit the ammunition and petrol storage hut behind the pillbox, and a large explosion covered the bridge in flame that would burn throughout the night. Later, a convoy of German lorries carrying ammunition supplies attempted to cross the burning bridge. Yeah, the flames exploded the ammunition that they carried, and this only added to the inferno. Another convoy, a V2 rocket unit, was also ambushed on the Arnhem side, and several men were taken prisoner, although the British didn't realise they were V2 rocket operators, which meant that the V2 rocket operators survived the battle. But overall, part of the British paratrooper force was at the bridge, and they just had to wait for relief by 30 Corps. So where were the tanks? 30 Corps had to go, what, 13 miles between their start point and the city of Eindhoven. Between Eindhoven and them was the German front line. After an artillery bombardment, German infantry and guns hit them from the woods on either side of the road, brewing up 9 tanks in the immediate ambush. The British deployed infantry and Typhoons from the RAF to deal with the Germans, and the infantry went in to clear the enemy positions, finally allowing 30 Corps to continue. By this point, the Germans were reacting to the attack, sending in 5 battalions to try and halt the advance. The whole day was spent fighting one new regiment after another that the British intelligence officers were even surprised existed. And by this point of the day, 30 Corps had only gone 8 miles from their starting point. There were another 56 miles to go to Arnhem, a bridge to build at Sonne, and many more Germans between them. At least all the bridges were taken on day one, and those that weren't could be rebuilt, except for one. Nijmegen Bridge was still in enemy hands, and the 82nd Airborne had yet to make an attack on it. Finally, at 8 p.m, Warren was able to send two rifle companies from the 1st Battalion towards the bridge. A and B companies attacked into Nijmegen, but B company got lost along the way, so A company went on alone. Yeah, only one company was attacking one of the main objectives in the entire operation, and it was many hours after the paratroopers had landed. As they approached the bridge, which at this point was still only guarded by a handful of Germans, a German convoy of reinforcements from the north arrived, and an entire infantry battalion from the 10th SS Panzer Division, supported by a company of engineers and Victor Graebner's reconnaissance battalion from 9th SS Panzer, arrived. The fighting began, but it was heavily in the Germans' favour. B Company arrived later in the night, but they too found the situation hopeless. The Americans did manage to capture and destroy the firing mechanism for the bridge, meaning the Germans weren't able to blow the bridge. Not they were planning to anyway, but they were outgunned and outnumbered now. The Germans even managed to counterattack and surround the unit in the post office, who would stay there for the next 3 days. We can safely say that the 82nd had failed to capture Nijmegen Bridge. The entire operation depending on the capture of every bridge. Sonne had been destroyed, but since it was over canal, a Bailey Bridge could be built in a matter of hours to replace it. But the bridge at Nijmegen spanned a much larger body of water, and a Bailey Bridge couldn't be built over that. Nijmegen Bridge had to be taken on the first day, and it wasn't. So things don't bode well for Operation Market Garden at this early stage, but there is still hope. If 1st Airborne could fight their way to Frost at the bridge, or if 30 Corps could make good their delay and reach and repair Sonne Bridge quickly, and or if the 82nd could somehow capture Nijmegen Road Bridge, which at this point is still a possibility, the battle could be won, and the war over by Christmas. The question is though, did the Allies make efficient use of the first vital hours of the operation, and who made the worst mistakes at this early stage? Let me know who you think it was in the comments below. We'll continue this fight tomorrow, but before we leave, it's worth mentioning SS Captain Victor Graebner one more time. This guy went everywhere on the 17th. First, he had a Knight's Cross pinned to his chest by Divisional Commander Hartzer early on the 17th, unlike what Wikipedia says, which is why we don't rely on it. Graebner sent units to scout out positions along the Ede-Arnhem Road. He fought elements of 1st Battalion, and then he drove across the Arnhem Bridge at about 6 o'clock, an hour or two before Frost's men even reached it. At 7 he was at Elst, south of Arnhem, and finding no paratroopers there, he raced to Nijmegen, and found no Americans at Nijmegen either. Yet, within 24 hours of this picture being taken, Graebner was dead. We'll find out why tomorrow. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing, bye for now. At 0900 hours on Monday the 18th of September 1944, SS Captain Victor Graebner, commander of the 9th SS Reconnaissance Battalion, drives his force across Arnhem Road Bridge from the south. Perhaps thinking he could surprise and shock the British paras into surrender, his half-tracks and Puma armoured cars rumbled into view of two paras' positions. Graebner's newly earned Knight's Cross reminded him that such tactics had worked before, but sadly, they wouldn't work this time. Yesterday we saw how the initial landings had gone smoothly, but then several things had gone wrong. Frost's men had failed to take the Arnhem Rail Bridge, but had successfully reached the Arnhem Road Bridge, whilst the rest of the division floundered around Oosterbeek. The 82nd had taken most of the bridges except for the vital Nijmegen Bridge, and were busy pounding the Reichswald. The 101st had taken most of their objectives, except for the bridges at Best and Sonne, both of which were destroyed. But they held the area around Sonne, and could put a Bailey Bridge across the canal once 30 Corps had arrived. And 30 Corps had fought hard to break through the German crust, which had been thicker than imagined. They still hadn't reached Eindhoven by day's end, and they were now behind schedule. But day two was now upon them, and it started with a bang, as Graebner's reconnaissance battalion headed north, across the Arnhem Row Bridge. He'd left some self-propelled guns at Nijmegen to help defend there and raced north to Arnhem, thinking only a handful of British paras held the north end of the bridge. He believed a quick attack across the bridge could dislodge the British from their positions. Remember, nobody knew exactly how many British there were, and Graebner thought he was facing a smaller force than his. His battalion, consisting of half-tracks, armoured cars and trucks carrying infantry, drives across the bridge. Some of Graebner's vehicles actually make it all the way across, and things look good until one vehicle strikes a British anti-tank mine, and then all hell breaks loose. Concentrated rifle and machine gun fire from both sides riddled the open half-tracks, killing crew and passengers alike. Mortar fire rained down on the Germans, and grenades were lobbed into the open hatches of the armoured cars. Chaos and confusion disrupts the attack, and Graebner is killed. More vehicles tried in vain to continue the advance, basically feeding the defeat, and it wasn't until midday until the fighting finally came to an end. In 2 hours, 12 vehicles out of the 22 that took part in this attack burned on the bridge, and the largest concentration of armoured vehicles in 9th SS Panzer Division had been cut to pieces. What this represented was a change in the battlefield. Day one had been about movement, capturing objectives quickly, by surprise, but now the fronts were beginning to solidify. Fluid and daring manoeuvres gave way to positional warfare. Foxholes were dug, lines were forming, positions were taken and fortified. Rapid attacks really weren't going to bring about a victory now. The moment had passed for decisive attacks. It was now going to be an attritional infantry slog. Frost men at the bridge had fought off Graebner's attack, but were not in the best situation. Surrounded by Germans and now short of ammunition, they hoped either 1st Airborne or 30 Corps would reach them soon. They had to reach them soon. But by this point, 30 Corps hadn't even reached the 101st Airborne Division at Eindhoven, 50 miles to the south of Arnhem. They had a bridge to rebuild at Sonne. They had a bridge to take at Nijmegen, and time was ticking down. The Germans were now counterattacking positions of the 101st, and by the end of the day, they had actually retaken the bridges at Best and the Wilhelmer Canal. 30 Corps would reach the 101st at Eindhoven by about 12:30, and would get to Sonne in the early evening, where they would found the destroyed bridge. They began to construct the Bailey Bridge that would allow them to continue their advance to Arnhem. However, the Bailey Bridge wouldn't be finished this day, with the result that 30 Corps was now massively behind schedule. Equally as concerning, 1st Airborne Division was still miles to the west of Arnhem and desperately trying to break through to 2nd Battalion at the bridge. Before dawn, Fitch's 3rd Battalion, accompanied by General Urquhart, moved from Oosterbeek and gained a mile and a half of ground without much opposition. However, as they reached the western suburbs of Arnhem, they were blocked by Camp Group Spindler. It was at this point that General Urquhart found himself confused in the street fighting, and trying to get back towards Oosterbeek, ended up trapped in a house in western Arnhem. A self-propelled gun parked itself outside his position, leaving the whole of 1st Airborne Division without their leader. Sat with him was Lathbury, who was in charge of the 1st Parachute Brigade, the units that were fighting towards the bridge. Without leadership to organise the attacks, the battalions fighting towards the bridge struggled to make any headway. For the rest of the day, 3rd Battalion were pinned down in the street fighting on the outskirts of Arnhem, making very little progress. And by the day's end, only 140 men of 3rd Battalion were left. Further back, 1st Battalion had marched through the night and were now in Oosterbeek. Their commander, Dobby, was not in contact with 3rd Battalion and assumed they had gone on ahead to the bridge. He therefore attempted to march straight into Arnhem. His troops reached the railway embankment at around 5:30 in the morning, but suffered casualties. Knowing his unit would be useless if it didn't get to its objective in one piece, he decided to avoid fighting and turned south. He linked up with stragglers from 3rd Battalion, and by about 8 o'clock they had passed the railway line, but were then fired upon by Germans in nearby houses and armoured cars at Den Brink. There was now no other option but to fight their way forwards. 1st Battalion, with elements of 3rd Battalion, fought through sniper and machine gun fire to clear out the buildings between them and the rest of 3rd Battalion. But by late afternoon, the exhausted paras had only just caught up with the remnants of 3rd Battalion. Despite advanced elements being only around 800 yards from the bridge, they would go no further this day. Back at 1st Airborne Headquarters at the Hartenstein Hotel, things were looking better-ish. Lieutenant Colonel Charles McKenzie now informed Brigadier Hicks that he was now in charge of 1st Airborne, since Urquhart had disappeared. Urquhart had issued orders that in the event that himself and Lathbury, who was sat in the same house with him, were lost, that Hicks would be next in line. And then, if Hicks was lost, then Brigadier Hackett would be in command. So Hicks, hearing reports that 1st and 3rd Battalion were struggling to get to Frost at the bridge, decided to send the South Staffords and 11th Battalion of Hackett's brigade to help them, as soon as the 2nd Airlift arrived. Remember, not all of 1st Airborne had gone in on the first day. 11th Battalion hadn't even arrived yet, and half the South Staffords hadn't arrived either. A good chunk of 1st Airborne had to guard the landing zones for the reinforcements that were expected. But these reinforcements were delayed for 4 hours. It wasn't until the afternoon that the second lift arrived. So the South Staffords went to Arnhem in the morning, taking a similar route as 1st Battalion, and managed to catch up to 1st Battalion later in the day. And when the second lift did arrive, Brigadier Hicks informed his technically superior in rank Brigadier Hackett that his 11th Battalion was now being taken from him and sent to reinforce the Arnhem relief attempt. The result? 11th Battalion sat for at least 2 hours, perhaps longer, outside the Hartenstein Hotel as the two brigadiers argued over how 11th Battalion should best be deployed. Hackett, who wasn't exactly pleased that his inferior was in charge of the division, thought that the situation was untidy and had not been informed until now that his own troops had been taken from him. Ultimately, 11th Battalion, commanded by Lieutenant Colonel George Lee, and the second half of the South Staffords managed to reach the west end of Arnhem by the closing hours of day two. So the situation at Arnhem wasn't great, but the good news was that a good portion of the British powers are now in the same area and about to launch an attack that would hopefully relieve Frost at the bridge. That attack will go in tomorrow. Further to the south, the 101st were now battling against, well, several German units. The previous day had seen only minor skirmishes, but now Student was able to pull in new units and start counterattacking. Student, as you remember, was the leader of the German paratroopers, the Fallschirmjäger, and, quote, "I knew more than anybody else that an airborne landing is at its weakest in the first few hours and must be sorted out quickly and determinedly." He therefore threw units at the 101st, even though most were of poor quality, simply because he wanted to hit the Americans early. At this point, his men were trainee Fallschirmjäger and police units, but he knew that the 15th Army was arriving from across the Scheldt. Starting on the evening of the first day, but really got going on the 18th, Kampfgruppe Rink, the 59th Infantry Division, and the Fallschirmjäger Battalion, Ewald, all struck against the elite American paratroopers. Luckily for the Allies, the attacks went in piecemeal and were therefore beaten back, having little impact on this day. But Student was able to start pulling in the 107th Panzer Brigade from Helmand. This was an entirely different kettle of fish. Armed with deadly Panther medium tank and Panzer Grenadier infantry, this force could overcome the lightly armed American paratroopers. However, it could only move at night for fear of the Allied air attacks, so Student would have to wait until tomorrow, day 3, to use them. In the middle at Nijmegen, the 82nd successfully held the Groesbeek Heights overnight against no German attacks, but on the morning of the 18th, the Germans sent in the 406th Division to take the heights. Except the day before, this division wasn't really a division. It consisted of a HQ unit and a few training units, but by the 18th, General Scherbening had cobbled together some inexperienced Luftwaffe, eyes and ears battalions, and artillery units, and kind of called it a division. In reality, it was little more than maybe 4 battalions in strength, and may have been weaker than that. What is certain is that they had very few heavy weapons, and many of the soldiers had no practical infantry training. Early on the 18th, this force attacked the elite American paratroopers dug in at the Groesbeek Heights, and somehow managed to take some of the drop zones, killing, wait for it, 11 Americans, and wounding some more. But by 1 o'clock, the second wave of American paratroopers dropped from the skies, and coupled with an attack by the paratroopers already on the ground, the German units were routed from the field, with the loss of, wait for it, 1,000 men killed or captured. This was the only serious attack on the Groesbeek Heights in the first few days of the operation, and it ended in disaster for the Germans. A little to the north, a German engineer battalion of the 10th SS Panzer Division was now running a ferry across the Panadern Canal. Progress was slow, but units were steadily getting across and marching to Nijmegen. Kampfgruppe Henk occupied positions around Hunter Park and was now being reinforced by half tracks and more infantry who came across the Waal on dinghies, rather than face fire if they tried to cross the bridge. German forces found themselves winning, as Gavin had pulled back some of the paratroopers to help at Groupspeak. There was now a lull in the fighting. The Germans gathered more forces and Kampfgruppe Rheinhold took up Henck's old positions as Kampfgruppe Henck now moved to secure the nearby railway bridge, which at this point hadn't seen any action at all. Rheinhold dug trenches, almost completely unopposed by the 82nd, 88mm guns were positioned across the river, and armoured vehicles moved into the city. Mines were laid, buildings that were in the way of their defensive plans were demolished. The centre of Nijmegen was now fully in German hands, and they had the entire day to fortify it. It's worth noting at this point that as day 2 comes to a close, the situation across most of the battlefield is stable and in Allied control. 30 Corps had reached the 101st and would soon have a Bailey Bridge up and running. The 82nd had successfully held the Groupspeak Heights against a German division that hadn't existed the day before and barely existed even now. And at Arnhem, though the British hadn't got many troops at the bridge, Frost's men were dug in and potentially could be reinforced by a large force of British powers who were only 800 yards away from them. And yet there was one vital piece of the puzzle that needed to be grasped. Nijmegen, the only bridge on day 2 that still hadn't been secured at any point so far. Nijmegen city was now a fortress and garrisoned by an ever-growing number of elite German SS Panzergrenadiers. 82nd Airborne had failed to take this crucial objective, and as day 2 comes to a close, and even after additional reinforcements to the 82nd, no effort was being made to correct this issue. The Germans at Nijmegen now blocked the road to Arnhem. Think about it, if the Allies don't take Nijmegen Bridge soon, 1st Airborne would be isolated and potentially crushed. Without Nijmegen, there could be no Arnhem, and the whole operation would be doomed. If the 82nd had taken Nijmegen and the bridge there, rather than concentrating on the Groupspeak Heights, how would things have played out? Would it have been better or worse than the situation we have now? I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing, bye for now. If everything goes to plan, you'll be relieved in 2 days. If not 2, then 3 days. Well, this was the day the British tanks were meant to be rolling over Arnhem Bridge. And when we left yesterday, almost everything seemed to be going great for Operation Market Garden. Every bridge along the route, except one, was in Allied hands, and although the British tanks were still 50 miles to the south at Sonne, by the morning of day 3, the Bailey Bridge was finished, the road ahead looked clear. The question is, would they make it? Yesterday we saw stall attempts made by 1st Airborne to get to Frost's troops at the bridge, while Frost himself and 2nd Battalion continued to hold on. Ammunition and food supplies were running low, so relief was desperately needed now. The 82nd had destroyed the German attack from the Reichswald for only a handful of losses, but only made token attempts to take the Nijmegen Bridge. Nijmegen was now a German fortress. 101st continued to fight on all fronts, especially near Best, whilst building a Bailey Bridge at Sonne since 30 Corps had finally arrived. The 19th of September was a Tuesday. It's day 3 of Operation Market Garden. The good news was that 30 Corps and the 101st had finally constructed the Bailey Bridge at Sonne and were able to advance. Up to this point, 30 Corps had gone 18 miles from their initial starting position. This may seem slow, and it was, but they were about to make up for it. The tanks reached Vegel by 7:30 in the morning, and by 8:30 they covered another 14 miles, reaching the 82nd at Grave. In 2 hours, they'd advanced further than they'd gone in the previous 2 days, around 24 miles. 42 hours after starting the operation, they were now at Nijmegen, and only about 8 miles from the British at Arnhem. There was a good chance that they'd reach the British in time. They still had an entire day left to go, the final 8 miles to Arnhem. 8 miles. Except the 82nd Airborne still hadn't taken Nijmegen Bridge, the only bridge not taken intact or not on the first day, and hadn't been in Allied hands at all. Nijmegen Bridge was now guarded by a lot of SS infantry, supported by self-propelled guns, 88mm guns and artillery, and they'd had plenty of time, unopposed by the 82nd, to fortify Nijmegen City. For the past 2 days, most of the 82nd Airborne had sat on the Groupspeak Heights. There had been no attacks at Groupspeak on the first day. On the second day, a paper German division had been repulsed without much trouble, and the Germans didn't mount any serious attacks on the heights the entire third day. The American units dug in at Groupspeak along with Gavin and Browning had no impact on what was now becoming a hard-fought house-to-house brawl for the city of Nijmegen and the southern end of the Nijmegen Bridge. As British tanks and infantry moved towards Hunter Park, they came into the sights of the German 88mm guns. Several tanks brewed up and the fighting began, and would rage on for hours, with little ground gained on this day. Nijmegen was still in German hands. The Germans had two Kampfgruppen in the city under the overall control of Kampfgruppe Rheinhold, which was located in Lent, just north of Nijmegen. One Kampfgruppe, Uhling, held Hunter Park and the Nijmegen Row Bridge. The other, Kampfgruppe Henk, guarded the Nijmegen Rail Bridge. Uhling only had around 100 men at his disposal, backed by four assault guns, but they were veteran SS soldiers supported by a much larger contingent of artillery than they normally should have had. SS Lieutenant Colonel Sonnenstahl had four oversized batteries at his disposal, coupled with a unique way of delivering that artillery by putting boxes on a map and naming or numbering them so that it was much easier for forces on the ground to call in artillery support. Sonnenstahl was able to bring down copious amounts of fire and stall Allied assaults. Hamel attributed the successful defence of Nijmegen to this artillery support, which allowed, over the course of the battle, the small force of SS troops to maintain their positions against a much larger attacking force. Nijmegen wouldn't fall into Allied hands this day. But it's okay, Frost was holding the bridge at Arnhem. Just, there was now two Kampfgruppen surrounding him, and they attacked on all sides. Kampfgruppe Brinkmann continued to attack from the east, and Kampfgruppe Knaust, a heavier battle group, now attacked from the north. At the beginning of the day, two Paris perimeters still consisted of 10 out of the original 18 houses they'd occupied on day one. But now the Germans were receiving a heavy stream of reinforcements. 88mm guns were brought up to pound the buildings, and two Tiger tanks managed to get through the wreck of vehicles on the bridge and cross from the southern side of the Rhine. Artillery fired from across the river, including Nebelwerfers, hammered the British positions. The battle was now fully in the Germans' favour as assault guns, Mark 3 and Mark 4 tanks rolled from the east. Two Power was being blasted out from its positions, one strong point at a time, but the Germans didn't have it all their own way. Rubble blocked the streets, making it difficult for tanks to move up, and a few vehicles and tanks were knocked out in the fighting. The Powers were down to scraps of ammunition, yet they continued to resist. They did get some artillery support from 1st Airborne, which did result in the Germans turning their guns on the church spires, thinking artillery spotters were in them. But this wasn't the case. According to Urquhart, Frost and Gough discussed the likelihood of Gough and his recce boys scolding across the bridge at last light to try and force a link with 30 Corps. You know it's desperate when the forces in need of relief are actually considering aiding the relieving forces. The idea was dropped, but the resistance continued, despite the fact that Frost had to order his men to stop sniping at the Germans to conserve the little ammunition they had left. The British now found it difficult to move between the buildings as German machine guns would just open up in the spaces between them. German infantry had to assault the British houses and literally drag the Powers out of their positions. It seemed a hopeless situation for the British, but they fought on, hoping that reinforcements would come from either 1st Airborne or from the south. It's worth noting that as long as 2nd Battalion continued to hold out in Arnhem, the Germans would have a difficult time reinforcing the 10th SS Panzer Division fighting at Nijmegen. The Germans were relying on the Panadern Canal to get their troops across the Rhine, but this was slow. What this meant was that the Germans at Nijmegen would receive no reinforcements until 2nd Battalion were defeated, and 2nd Battalion wouldn't receive reinforcements until the Germans at Nijmegen were defeated too. Effectively, there were two sieges going on at the same time, and whichever cracked first would decide the fate of the entire battle. If German resistance collapsed at Nijmegen, the British would get to Frost and be over the Rhine. If Frost is defeated, German reinforcements would stream into Nijmegen, and 1st Airborne would be doomed. There was still a chance for both sides to claim victory at this point. But the difference between the Germans at Nijmegen and Frost at Arnhem was that 2nd Battalion was potentially about to get reinforced from the west. 1st, 3rd, 4th and 11th Battalions, supported by the South Staffords and elements of 2nd Battalion who hadn't made it to the bridge, now attempted to break through to Frost. Dobby's 1st Battalion, half the South Staffords, went forwards first, supported by 3rd Battalion, who went in beside them. They cleared a few light defences where the Germans had made their main line the day before, but then everything went wrong. The Germans of Kampfgruppe Spindler had pulled back slightly from the previous day's positions, which did have the benefit of allowing Urquhart to escape his prison and make his way back to Divisional HQ, but it also meant that the Germans now outflanked the British from all sides. And these weren't eyes and ears battalions. This was the 9th SS Panzer Division, armed with tanks, artillery, self-propelled guns. Some occupied the route ahead, others occupied the ridge to the north, and more were positioned across the river in the brickworks to the south. The lightly armed British paratroopers, backed by, well, little artillery and no air support or tanks, and exhausted on the third day of fighting, were hopelessly caught in a crossfire. 1st and 3rd Battalion were pinned down by the Germans at about 6:30 after only 2 hours of attack. Those that survived were either wounded or ran out of ammunition and were forced to surrender in the next hour or so. The 140 men of 3rd Battalion had been more or less wiped out. 1st Battalion and the first half of the South Staffords suffered much of the same fate. The second half of the South Staffords now went in, but found themselves facing German tanks and self-propelled guns near the museum. Pinned down and with no anti-tank guns, they had to rely on Piats to take out the tanks, but by about 11:30 they'd also run out of Piat anti-tank rounds. The Germans now counter-attacked and overwhelmed the South Staffords, who were forced to pull back through 11th Battalion position. 11th Battalion, commanded by Lee, had been ordered by Urquhart to wait. He wasn't happy that attacks were going in piecemeal. As the South Staffords fell back, 11th Battalion was ordered to take the high ground north of the railway line, hopefully so they could mount a fresh attack later. But this took time to prepare, and as they were setting up, the Germans attacked them. Mortars rained down and tanks appeared. The 11th was in the open preparing to advance and was caught off guard by the Germans, and in a hopeless situation, the battalion basically evaporated. Lee was taken prisoner and maybe 150 men got away. The rest were either killed or captured. The last attempt to break through to Frost at the bridge had failed, with a huge loss to the British. 1st Brigade had been torn to pieces, and now in the early afternoon the situation at Divisional HQ in Oosterbeek looked bleak. The Germans were attacking into Oosterbeek from the east, and the landing zones could no longer be held. This was the same day that the first of the RAF resupply drops fell into enemy hands. 1st Airborne did receive some reinforcements from a Polish glider unit landing in Landing Zone L. Unfortunately, this went disastrously wrong for the Polish, as they landed on top of 10 Paras Battalion as they retreated south near Wolfhaze. The Polish were quite literally shot out the sky, and this didn't help 10th Paras retreat. Chaos and confusion reigned, and Kraft was able to push the 10th and 156th Battalions, both now down to about 250 men each, and the surviving Poles beyond the railway line. Urquhart desperately tried to organise a defence as the light faded. He would later refer to the 19th as a dark and fateful day. At Arnhem, everything was going wrong. Remember that Bailey Bridge at Somme? You know, the one built overnight? It had been incredibly important in the day's events, allowing British tanks to roll on to Nijmegen. At 5:15, as the American paratroopers sat in their positions in and around Somme, watching British trucks drive across the bridge, the Somme church tower exploded. Falling debris startled the Americans as more explosions erupted from the schoolhouse. General Taylor came out of the schoolhouse to see enemy infantry and Panther tanks approaching from the south. Panzer Brigade 107 had arrived. General Student had brought Panzer Brigade 107 up from Helmand, and it was now just yards from the newly built Bailey Bridge at Somme. A British truck was actually hit as it crossed the bridge. It exploded and sent flames over the span and into the canal. The Americans reacted to the attack as best they could, and even managed to destroy 2 Panther tanks. One was knocked out in sight of the Bailey Bridge. Fighting continued as darkness fell, and only after the attack bogged down did Panzer Brigade 107 withdraw. 2 tanks had been knocked out, but they had almost succeeded in severing the supply line to the rest of 30 Corps, and they weren't defeated yet. So if we compare the situation at the beginning of Day 3 to the end of Day 3, things had changed. 30 Corps wasn't at Arnhem as expected. Instead, they were fighting a house-to-house battle for the city and bridge at Nijmegen. The 101st at Somme built a Bailey Bridge in the morning and only just managed to prevent it from falling into German hands in the evening. And the last attempt to get to Frost had failed. Now the British at Oosterbeek were in a desperate state as the Germans closed in on all sides. Frost still clung on to Arnhem Bridge though. There was still a chance of victory for both sides. Everything was now at stake. Who would fall first, the British at Arnhem or the Germans at Nijmegen? Tomorrow would be the last chance to get to Frost at Arnhem, and it would require a lot more fighting and a daring feat of bravery from the soldiers of the 82nd Airborne. The 19th truly was a dark and fateful day, a turning point. But do you think victory could still have been achieved at this point, or was it already too late? And guys, if you have any questions about this battle, comment below and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing. Bye for now. The Mad Colonel. That's what the Germans nicknamed John Frost, who still clung on to a handful of buildings at Arnhem Bridge. Frost's men fought desperately, with their ammunition running out and the houses collapsing and burning around them. Where was 30 Corps? Where were the tanks? They were 8 miles to the south, fighting against the 10th SS Panzer Division, who were clinging on to the bridge at Nijmegen. Both Frost and 10th SS Panzer would fight two mirrored last stands as the outcome of Operation Market Garden hung in the balance. Who would fall first? Yesterday was truly a dark and fateful day. The British forces trying to get to Frost's men at Arnhem were almost wiped out, having been caught in a crossfire. The rest of 1st Airborne were pushed off their landing zones as General Urquhart, now back in charge of the division, tried to form a coherent defence. 30 Corps had reached Nijmegen, making up for lost time, but were stopped as the 82nd had failed to take Nijmegen Bridge. The Germans at Nijmegen were now under siege, but held on despite Allied attempts to break through. The 101st had helped build a Bailey Bridge at Sonne in the morning, but fought to hold it in the evening against Panther tanks of Panzer Brigade 107. It was now the 20th of September, a Wednesday, day 4 of Operation Market Garden. The tanks should have reached Arnhem yesterday, but they hadn't. 30 Corps was still 8 miles from Arnhem, and Nijmegen Bridge was still in German hands. But if they could break through now, there was a chance of victory, even at this late stage. 10th SS Panzer Division held onto Nijmegen and the bridge with perhaps 500 men, backed by assault guns, 88mm guns, mortars and artillery. When the British set up for their attack, artillery rained down on them and stopped them in their tracks, just like the day before. Attempt after attempt was made to smash through the German defenders, but Kampfgruppe Henk and Uhling, under the command of Kampfgruppe Reinhold, fought them off. The stiffness of the German defence in Nijmegen throughout the day didn't seem to be weakening, so the Allies decided that only a desperate action could save the day. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Sherman's blasted the opposite side of the Val as Major Cook's 3rd Battalion paddled in boats across the river. This was perhaps the most heroic and daring act of World War II, as American paratroopers stormed across a river in boats, assaulted a riverbank like Marines, which they weren't trained for, just to take the Nijmegen Bridge from the other side. Unbelievably, under a hail of rifle, machine gun and mortar fire, half the boats made it to the north bank. As the boats turned back to pick up the next wave of troops, American paratroopers overwhelmed the old men and young boys who'd been killing them moments before. This was a decisive tactical victory for the Allies, which unhinged the German defence completely. The Germans had nothing left. There were so few units to form a defensive line that the Americans, supported by British sappers, were able to secure the beachhead and press on towards the Nijmegen Bridge. Yes, you don't hear that often, but the American paratroopers were accompanied by British sappers. And the crossing was a joint effort. They managed to get to the northern end of the Nijmegen Bridge, and as they did, four Sherman tanks from the British Grenadier Guards attack from the south. The tanks moved across the span of the bridge, killing the Germans in the girders. Just to point out another myth of this battle, the Germans in the girders were most likely engineers, not snipers as often described. They were perhaps trying to rig the bridge to blow, but nobody's quite sure. After the war, Hamel was convinced that there weren't snipers on the bridge. Either way, it was at this point that SS Colonel Hamel decided to blow the road bridge. His orders from Field Marshal Model were to keep the road bridge intact so Germany could launch counterattacks in the future. This was an unrealistic eventuality since Germany had little offensive capability left, and Hamel understood that if he blew the bridge now, it would prevent the Allies from getting to Arnhem. As the British Sherman tanks crossed the bridge, he ordered the bridge to blow, but by some miracle the explosive failed to go off. Lucky though the British were that the bridge was now in their hands, they were unable to advance. The four tanks that had gone to the other side of the Val were alone. The few American paratroopers they had with them weren't willing or able to advance. It's often been said that an American paratrooper became angry at the British tankers for not advancing with them to Arnhem. This is fiction. Another myth of the battle made up after the event. In fact, the American paratroopers may have even left the tanks at the bridge to go and fight the Germans elsewhere. What is certain is that a handful of American paratroopers who'd linked up with the tanks were too few in number to go on and in any event were in no position to take orders from the British. Their orders were to hold the other side of the bridge, and it was now up to the British to advance. Fortunately, without infantry support, the British tanks would be unable to advance. So where were the British infantry? 30 Corps has often been accused of being too slow after the capture of Nijmegen Bridge. But the reality was that the British infantry and tanks were still fighting against the Germans who held on at Nijmegen. They couldn't just leave a good portion of the 10th SS Panzer Division there sitting in their rear. Some of the German defenders, seeing the successful amphibious assault, decided to flee across the railway bridge, with around 250 dying on the bridge itself. The Germans lost control of the Nijmegen railway bridge, but fighting continued in the city. Artillery fire rained down on the British, preventing them from overwhelming the last pockets of resistance. Holding on for a few more hours, the Germans finally realized their position was hopeless. Some once again tried to flee across the bridges, now in enemy hands. Others, such as survivors of Camp Group Uhling, who'd held on to Hunter Park, managed to slip under the Nijmegen Road Bridge and escape to the east. The British wouldn't clear the last elements of resistance from Nijmegen until the early hours of the next day, and it wasn't until Nijmegen was secure that the British infantry and the rest of 30 Corps could have continued their advance to Arnhem. So why was it at the time and after the war that 30 Corps was accused of being so slow? Why were they accused of drinking tea on the northern end of the Nijmegen Bridge whilst their comrades at Arnhem were left to bleed? We'll come back to that question in the last episode of the series, but I'd love to hear your opinions in the comments below. As the fighting came to a head in Nijmegen, things further south weren't easy either. As the morning mist cleared at Somme, the Americans guarding the Bailey Bridge that had been built on the previous night could be forgiven for thinking they'd done their part. The day before, they'd stopped the German counterattack, which had nearly got to the bridge, and could be satisfied that they completely secured the line. They were wrong. Panzer Brigade 107 achieved complete surprise by attacking the exact same way they'd done the day before. You see, the Germans never attacked in the same place twice. It just wasn't done. In theory, if you attack the same place twice, the enemy, well, would be prepared. That was why the Germans never did it, but that's exactly why they did it this day, to throw the Americans off guard. It wasn't long before they dominated the Bailey Bridge with fire once again. However, in the nick of time, 10 British tanks appeared and managed to destroy 4 more German tanks and turn the tide of the battle in their favour. Unable to take the bridge, Panzer Brigade 107 withdrew. It had once again been close to cutting the Allied corridor. This wasn't the only attack on the corridor this day. 406th Division, which had attacked out of the Reichswald Forest near Grusbeek 2 days ago, was finally reinforced. Fallschirmjäger, German paratroopers, perhaps a few hundred strong, joined the already weak 406th Division and now formed 3 Kampfgruppen. Kampfgruppe Becker, with perhaps 800 men, would strike Grusbeek on the northern end of the battlefield and aim to take the Marswal Canal. Kampfgruppe Greschnick, with perhaps 500 men, attacked Grusbeek centre. And Kampfgruppe Hermann was positioned in the south and would hope to strike through Moog and cut off the bridges on the Marswal Canal. Starting in the morning, by 11 o'clock, the battle raged for the Grusbeek Heights. Beek, Weiler and Moog fell quickly, and Kampfgruppe Greschnick's unit managed to take some of the outskirts of Grusbeek itself. But an American counterattack in the afternoon, supported by British tanks, forced the Germans back from Moog and Grusbeek, and the attack in the north was halted. This was the first serious attack on the Grusbeek Heights so far. It was 4 days after the operation had begun, and well after 30 Corps had arrived. But at least the 82nd had 4 days to prepare themselves for the fight. It was only now, at the extreme northern end of the battlefield, that Urquhart came to the conclusion that he had to abandon the idea of relieving Frost in the bridge. To use his own words, "With a weak force now left, I could no longer hope to reach Frost than reach Berlin." Later in the same day, he finally made contact with Frost over the radio. Urquhart told him he wasn't certain if it was a case of me coming for them or they coming for us. And so, with 1st Airborne Division abandoning all hope of getting to Frost's beleaguered troops at Arnhem Bridge, they instead had to look for their own defence. Previous day's action had seen their attacking force in Arnhem decimated by the Germans. 1st Parachute Brigade no longer existed, and the remnants of several battalions fell back to Oosterbeek. The landing zones were overrun, and supplies were now dropping to the Germans rather than to themselves. German tanks were pressing upon their lines. Urquhart decided the remaining units should fall back to positions immediately around Oosterbeek. He had to form a defence quickly before the remainder of the division was wiped out. Throughout the day, Urquhart tried to salvage what was left of the original Market Garden plan. if he could no longer get to Arnhem Bridge, he would hold Oosterbeek and hopefully keep a crossing point open for 30 Corps. It was a desperate plan, but it might just work. The casualty list for 1st Airborne was staggering. It was no longer a division, but a few stragglers and small groups falling back to Oosterbeek. But if they could hold on to Oosterbeek and the Heathdorp ferry, a Bailey Bridge could be set up across the Rhine and victory could still be clawed from the jaws of defeat. With this in mind, he told Corps HQ to change the Polish drop zone to Driel, near the southern end of the ferry. If the Polish held the southern end of the river and the rest of 1st Airborne held the northern end, there was a chance that 30 Corps could still cross the Rhine. It was a desperate plan, but a plan it was. In the east, Kampfgruppe Spindler crossed the railway lines and reached the east of Oosterbeek. To the west, von Tettau's Kampfgruppe pushed the British back from their drop zones and took Wolfhays. 4th Brigade of the British Paras did manage to stall the attacks for a time, mauling part of Crass' attack and even counterattacked, despite their orders saying to retreat. Hackett fought alongside his men, brandishing a German gun, trying to desperately get them back towards Oosterbeek. During the confused fighting in the woods, there was no real front line as such, just groups of units moving around, ambushing and sniping each other. Towards the evening, Hackett's remnants fell back to Oosterbeek and recognisable lines were finally formed. Both sides took sizeable losses in the day's fighting, and this is perhaps the reason why von Tettau decided not to deliver Coup de Grace and destroyed the British pocket completely as they retreated, which some historians think may have been possible. Either way, by the evening of the 20th, the British pocket was formed at Oosterbeek, and the fluid movement of the past few days ended. The siege had begun. These were 1st Airborne's dispositions at the end of the day, 20th of September 1944. 10th and 156th Battalions, who had fought their way back into Oosterbeek from the west during the day, were now guarding the eastern side of Oosterbeek that evening. This was because 1st, 3rd and 11th Battalions were so badly mauled they were merely scraps of the units they once were. Lieutenant Colonel Thompson took command of this force, which was nicknamed the Thompson Force, but Thompson was later wounded and from the 21st onwards, tomorrow, Major Lonsdale took command of this battle group, which was then renamed the Lonsdale Force. 21st Independent Parachute Company, together with the 7th Battalion King's Own Scottish Borderers, held the northern end of Oosterbeek around Hotel Dreyrud, a building soon nicknamed the White House. 9th Airborne Field Company and 1st Border held the western side of Oosterbeek, and inside this ring were glider pilots who fought alongside the troops, the Royal Artillery, which was located towards the southern end of the pocket, and a divisional HQ, which was located at the Hartenstein Hotel, continued to hold out. Little more than 3,600 men remained of 1st Airborne, and supplies of all kinds were running low. But Urquhart had successfully created a defence around Oosterbeek, even though it wasn't a complete ring and was more groups of soldiers dug in at strong points. Frost's position was now perilous. Movement was almost impossible, and the few buildings they had left on the western side of Arnhem Bridge were surrounded. Truces allowed the defenders to evacuate their wounded, which included their leader, Frost himself. They'd run out of everything. Food, water, ammunition. In fact, the Germans were also so low of ammunition that many of them resorted to using captured British rifles and Sten guns, as their own logistics struggled to keep up. The shortcoming of the German supply system was alleviated by the Allied resupply drops, which, as we mentioned, were falling into German hands. The Germans blasted the British houses at the bridge at point-blank range. They had Tiger tanks at hand, including the latest shipment of Königsteiger or King Tiger tanks. The lightly armed paratroopers had no effective countermeasures against these heavy German tanks. Luckily, rubble prevented German vehicles from manoeuvring with ease, but this only slowed the inevitable. There was only a handful of buildings left now, and many of them were on fire. So at 7:30, the British and Americans took the Nijmegen Bridge, but it would take all night to clear Nijmegen, so they could continue the northern attack. As this day comes to an end, we see the end of two sieges, Arnhem Bridge and Nijmegen. Elements of Two Power continued to hold just, but they had no influence over the bridge now. For both sides, it was now a race to engage each other in the area between Nijmegen and Arnhem, an area known as the Island. We'll find out how that race goes tomorrow. If you could rate the video and let me know how I'm doing, that'd be great. Otherwise, thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing, bye for now. Total victory was now out of the question, but the tanks had to get to Oosterbeek, where 1st Airborne were being besieged in a pocket. what the Germans called the Hexenkessel, or Witch's Cauldron. Over the next 2 days, the British raced north to Nijmegen to get to the paratroopers, and the Germans raced south from Arnhem to stop them. If the British get to Oosterbeek, and if they can get reinforcements across the river, there's still a chance they could claw their way to victory. Last time we saw Frost's perimeter shrink to a few houses, while Frost himself is taken prisoner. 1st Airborne was forced back to Oosterbeek to form some sort of defence. 3rd Battalion of the 504th heroically crossed the Waal and took the north side of the Nijmegen Bridge as tanks of 30 Corps crossed the span. German resistance continued in Nijmegen though for several hours, preventing the British from striking north. And the 101st held against a surprise attack, again, from Panzer Brigade 107. In this episode, I'm going to cover 2 days, the 21st of September and the 22nd. Let's start with the 21st, a Thursday, day 5 of Operation Market Garden. At Arnhem Bridge, the last gasps of two para could be heard as they held on in the hope of relief, but it was all in vain. Organised British resistance collapsed sometime in the morning of the 21st of September, although it's worth mentioning that some lone British paratroopers continued to fight on until the 23rd. Arnhem was now totally within German hands. The last radio message from the bridge, picked up by Germans and not by any Allied unit, read, "Out of ammunition, God save the King." Frost men were finally overwhelmed at Arnhem, and the Germans had access to Arnhem Bridge and the road south. With the loss of Arnhem Bridge, total victory for the Allies was now impossible. But they still had a chance to get to the British at Oosterbeek and get a bridge across the Rhine. At least, that is what Urquhart hoped. Around 3,600 paratroopers held the newly formed perimeter at Oosterbeek. The important point to note at this time is that the Hevedorp ferry was still within British hands. Unfortunately, the ferry itself had been sunk the day before, just in case it fell into German hands. But the area was the best place near Oosterbeek to form a Bailey Bridge, since there were roads close by. Holding onto this area was therefore the last chance of victory, and it fell to a handful of men from 1st Border to keep Hevedorp in British hands. At around 8 o'clock in the morning, the Germans attacked from all sides of the Oosterbeek perimeter. They used assault guns and tanks to support their infantry assaults, but there was an unexpected stiffness to the British defences. Unlike in the previous day's actions, the British had a lot of troops in a very small, mostly wooded or urban area, and they were defending. This gave them an advantage they hadn't had in the past. 9th SS, championed by units like Kampfgruppe Spindler, attacked from the east. German snipers did manage to infiltrate the British positions, since there weren't enough British to form a solid defence line. These snipers took their toll, but the British resisted strongly. They took out some of the German tanks, or forced them back with heavy anti-tank fire. They even managed to capture a Sturmgeschütz assault gun from the Germans, but couldn't figure out how to use it, so they had to abandon it. However, 10th Battalion were decimated in the centre during these days, and only a handful of men were able to fall back. Despite this loss, the Germans maybe gained a couple of hundred metres of ground the entire day. In the west, von Tettau's untrained troops also made very little progress against the tight British defence, with British sniper fire now taking a heavy toll on the Germans as well. However, the Hevedorp ferry area was captured by the Germans after a heavy fight, and with it, the last chance of Operation Market Garden succeeded. British supplies were once again dropping behind enemy lines. The paras set up all manner of signals on the ground to try and sway the RAF to drop supplies to them, but they failed. The RAF was now suffering heavy losses, resupplying their enemy, who were using those supplies to fight the paras, who the supplies were meant to be for. But the good news for 1st Airborne was that today, contact was finally made with 30 Corps, and 30 Corps had artillery, which the belligerent paratroopers called in to stall the Germans. Steel rain blunted several German attacks, and the Germans thought their artillery was firing short, so they started firing flares to try and stop their own artillery firing. Nope, it was British artillery, and this would be a big reason for why the British would continue to hold out Oosterbeek over the next few days. Like at Nijmegen, artillery was useful in preventing attacks from forming, and when the British paras saw an attack forming, they'd simply call in artillery to disrupt the German attacks. More good news for 1st Airborne came in the afternoon. At 5 o'clock, a new armada covered the skies. The Polish Independent Parachute Brigade descended from the heavens. Now, weather in England had delayed the Poles from setting off. They were originally meant to be dropped 2 days earlier, on day 3 of the operation, and they were supposed to be dropped near Arnhem. But the situation had changed dramatically since then, so Urquhart changed the plan to, at the last minute, to drop the Poles north of Driel, which was to the south of the Rhine and south of the used-to-be Cauldron. Their task was to support 1st Airborne as best they could, and if possible, get men and supplies across the river. It was also to guard the approaches to the river, so 30 Corps could maybe attempt to cross it. However, things went wrong for the Poles right from the start. A portion of the Polish brigade didn't even take off from England, and whilst the Allies may have had air superiority over most of Europe, they did not over this battlefield. You see, in previous months, the RAF and US Air Force had dominated the skies, disrupting German movements and logistics, and bombed German ground units at the request of Allied units. But because the US Air Force feared mixing fighters with transport planes, there had been little to no air support available for the Allied units during Operation Market Garden. As a result, the German Luftwaffe was able to hunt down a portion of the American planes taking the Poles to their destination. General Urquhart was of the opinion after the war that the lack of air support was a deciding factor in this battle. Once the Poles reached Driel and parachuted to their destination, they realised two things. One, only around 1,000 men, perhaps less, of their entire brigade had made it. And two, the British at Oosterbeek had lost the area around the Heavedorp ferry. This threw off the original plan to have the Poles support 30 Corps in crossing the Rhine. Their only hope now was to try and assist 1st Airborne as best they could and maybe get troops across the river. The Germans were taken completely by surprise by the Polish landing. They feared the worst, that the Poles would get across the Rhine or perhaps even swing around their rear and capture the southern end of the Arnhem road bridge. That would cut off 9th SS's retreat as 30 Corps would crush them from the front. This was a fantasy because thousands or so paratroopers weren't capable of doing that, but nonetheless the Germans reacted quickly, sending in all reserves to form a blocking line, or Zwerreband, named after its commander, Harzer. Zwerreband Harzer consisted of 5 battalions, perhaps as many as 2,400 men, and now blocked the route to Arnhem. This force engaged the 1,000 or so Poles in Driel, as the Poles formed an all-round defence, waiting for 30 Corps to link up with them. The impact of the Polish drop is significant. Whilst they couldn't get across the Rhine, because the ferry was now lost, they did draw off all German reserves in the area. According to Robert J. Kershaw in his book, It Never Snows in September, the Germans had been planning to destroy the British at Oosterbeek in a planned attack on the 22nd. But now they had to take all their reserves to counter the Polish drop. If this is true, the Polish saved 1st Airborne from complete annihilation. The Polish drop would also give the Allies the last chance to cross the Rhine. 30 Corps sent reconnaissance units forwards to the area known as the Island. In this area, the main road was raised up above the surrounding fields, themselves split not by hedges, but by ditches and streams. Basically, British tanks advancing this way would be exposed to anything the Germans could fire at them, with little chance of retaliation. So even though 30 Corps resumed its attack towards Arnhem at 1:30 in the afternoon, it soon got bogged down in the fighting. 5 leading tanks were hit and set on fire by Panther and 88mm guns, and the attack ground to a halt. With the tanks unable to proceed, it was decided that the infantry should lead the attack, and the 43rd Infantry Division was picked for this role. Unfortunately, the 43rd Infantry Division was still stuck at Nijmegen, and the traffic up this one road, now referred to as Hell's Highway, was just awful, so the attack was delayed. The Germans were also sending in a steady stream of reinforcements into the island area, meaning that there was little chance of reaching either 1st Airborne or the Poles this day. The 22nd of September was a Friday, and it was now day 6 of Operation Market Garden. Like the day before, there was still hope that 30 Corps could reach the paratroopers at Oosterbeek and create some sort of victory. That chance was lost today, as Kampfgruppe Walther launched a counterattack, not in the north at the island, but at Vegel against the 101st. They aimed to cut the corridor, as they had done a couple of days earlier at Somme. Again, it was the Panther tanks of Panzer Brigade 107 that headed the attack. This time though, it was supported by grenadiers, flak batteries, artillery, Fallschirmjäger, tank destroyer battalion, and more. They would attack the right flank of the road, which is now nicknamed Hell's Highway by the Allies. On the left side of the road, another formation, Kampfgruppe Huber, also went in on the attack. This had infantry supported by artillery, anti-tank guns, and even 4 Jagdpanzer tank destroyers. This force would attack at Schindel, but aimed at Vegel. Despite a shortage of artillery shells, this was a concerted attack and proved devastating for the 101st and the British too. Shortly after 9 o'clock in the morning, the German attack went in. Artillery pounded the American positions, and tanks of Kampfgruppe Walther moved ahead. Vega was reached at around 11 with Panther tanks and Panzer Grenadiers cutting Hell's Highway from the north. They then turned south to Vega, where a battle erupted with the American 501st Regiment. On the other side of the road, Kampfgruppe Huber got into the outskirts of Schindel, where they were able to fire at Vega Canal Bridge. 506 Regiment, supported by British tanks, were able to push them back. Equally, 501st, supported by British tanks and an unending artillery bombardment, halted Kampfgruppe Walther. The Germans found themselves unable to continue the attack as night fell, but they had cut the corridor, and this meant that 30 Corps supplies and reinforcements wouldn't get through to the north. And the British desperately needed infantry reinforcements in the north. Some elements, including tanks of 43rd Division, managed to reach the Polish Independent Brigade at Driel sometime in the evening. But the island still caused problems, and the attack could not be made successfully towards Arnhem. Worse, tank units in Nijmegen that could be used for the advance were sent south to deal with the Vega cut. Clearly, the British attack was losing steam. Lieutenant Colonel Charles Mackenzie, the staff officer who told Hicks he was in command of 1st Airborne when Urquhart was missing, crossed the Rhine in a rowboat and spoke to the Polish commander, Sosabowski. He impressed upon Sosabowski the desperate situation in Oosterbeek Cauldron and said that even a handful of reinforcements could make all the difference. That night, 60 men from Sosabowski's brigade got across the river and reinforced the Oosterbeek perimeter. But 60 Polish paratroopers weren't enough to change the course of the battle. Harzer had decided that the British in the Oosterbeek pocket would be pounded into submission by mortars and Nebelwerth, rather than all-out attack. There were a few reasons behind this change in tactics. One was that a good portion of the German reinforcements had moved south to block the Polish landing and the British tanks. Essentially, the British pocket at Oosterbeek was now merely a distraction from the main event further south. Another reason was that the Germans left at Oosterbeek were mostly untrained conscripts backed by only a few veteran Kampfgruppen. These troops could not be capable of mounting the assaults needed to root out the British from their strong point. Attacks were still carried out, but it wasn't the all-out storming of positions that would overwhelm the paras from all sides kind of attack that the British were expecting. As a result, the British pocket remained virtually unchanged and the paras continued to hold. So the battle has shifted in the last couple of days. Frostmen fought on until the very end. The Poles had landed, causing the Germans to move reinforcements south, perhaps saving 1st Airborne from annihilation. 30 Corps had problems linking up with the Poles, especially since Hell's Highway had been cut near Vega, and the loss of the heaved-up ferry. It now seemed unlikely that the Allies could still achieve victory. If you were Urquhart and you had the choice of choosing the Polish landing zone, where would you drop them? Would you drop them at Driel? Would you land them south of Arnhem? Or would you land them somewhere on the north side of the Rhine to support 1st Airborne? Let me know in the comments below. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing, and bye for now. Hold on. Hold on until the tanks relieve you. Hold on without reinforcement or resupply. Hold on until victory. Except there won't be a victory. This battle is lost. It was lost days ago. You're just holding on until someone decides to get you out. Such was the fate of the British paras at Oosterbeek. Last time we saw the Poles drop at Driel and cause the Germans to shift their focus south of Arnhem, the corridor was cut at Vega and the British attacks in the north stalled. The Germans at Oosterbeek pounded the British paras whilst the Red Devils held on inside the Witch's Cauldron. This time we're going to cover the last few days of Operation Market Garden, starting from the 23rd of September and ending on the 26th. You'll be surprised to learn that the remaining airborne reinforcements flew in on the 23rd of September. Yes, 7 days after the beginning of the operation, the Poles received the rest of their brigade that hadn't taken off 2 days previously. The 101st and the 82nd also received additional reinforcements, including an entire regiment, the 325th Glider Infantry, that landed at Nijmegen. With additional reinforcements, the Allies pushed Kampfgruppe Walther back towards Gemert in the evening of the 23rd. Defeated it may have been, but Kampfgruppe Walther had cut Hell's Highway for 36 hours. Unfortunately, Walther was now in a poor position to attack the corridor once more, since British 8th Corps was now at Durren. Over the next couple of days, it would withdraw to Boxmeer and would play no further part in the battle. On the 24th, however, Kampfgruppe Huber, on the other side of the Hell's Highway, attacks towards Vega. This camp group was weaker than Walther, consisting of perhaps four Volksjäger battalions backed up by Jagdpanzer tank destroyers. But the Germans had done their reconnaissance. They'd found gaps in the American lines. Striking into Erd from Schindel, the German Jagdpanzers annihilated British tanks supported by American paratroopers. Several Shermans were taken out, and trucks burst into flames on Hell's Highway itself. Now, whilst the Germans hadn't got onto the road, they had prevented traffic from flowing north. Once again, the corridor was cut. Worse, another force from Kampfgruppe Huber attacked towards Kuvering the next day. Ambushing vehicles on the road, Volksjäger did enough damage to cut the road again. 50 vehicles were destroyed and the road was blocked here until the 26th, day 10 of Operation Market Garden, and basically the end. On the 24th, day 8th of the operation, a meeting was held at Valberg between Horrocks, Browning, Thomas and Sosabowski to decide what to do. Sosabowski pointed out that sending reinforcements into Oosterbeek was pointless. A major crossing could not be mounted because 30 Corps was stretched too thin and had logistical troubles in the south. Instead, Horrocks decided that small crossings would continue for the time being. Interestingly, he told Sosabowski that if he didn't like the idea of small crossings, he would be relieved of his command. Yes, Horrock was under pressure, but it may seem a little odd that Sosabowski was threatened with resignation. I'll go into more detail as to why there was a distrust of the Polish commander in the next and final episode of the series, but either way, on the 24th, more assault boats arrived and 300 men, mostly Poles, got into Oosterbeek. A lot were killed trying to make the crossing. With the corridor cut further south, 30 Corps struggled to press on towards Oosterbeek. On the evening of the 23rd, 130th Brigade finally reached the Poles at Driel, making this the first substantial connection 30 Corps had had with the forces fighting on the Rhine. They still fought the Germans at Elst and Bemmel and would take Oppenstein by the 26th. Even with the 300 man reinforcement and the arrival at last of Allied fighter bombers from the 23rd onward, the situation in Oosterbeek during the last few days of the operation remained bleak. Despite being assaulted by tanks, grenades and a host of other weapons, including flamethrowers, specially requested by German commanders and ordered by Model himself, somehow 1st Airborne continued to hold on. It was joked at the time that the British used German weapons since their ammunition had run out, and the Germans used British weapons since their logistics were strained and they were getting resupplied by the Allies via the air. And the Germans still didn't have enough troops to deliver a decisive blow on the cauldron. Worse, the troops that the Germans did have were suffering high casualties as they tried to storm each of the British strong points, since the defence of Oosterbeek was now a series of points rather than a continuous line. German commanders were angry that their troops were losing as many tanks as they were. The reason for the losses was because the German infantry weren't trained and were few in number, and because there was a shortage of radios amongst the Germans. British anti-tank guns and infantry managed to knock out numerous German vehicles, including Sturmgeschütz self-propelled guns and even some Panther tanks. Surprisingly, the German Königstiger or King Tiger tanks weren't that effective at Oosterbeek, mainly due to the narrow terrain which took off their tracks and prevented their turrets from turning. This was a little comfort to the British, who didn't realise that the Germans were reorganising their lines. The Germans pulled in all their veterans from the various Kampfgruppen that surrounded the British pocket and put them on the eastern side. It was hoped that this reorganisation would enable the Germans to pierce the British perimeter and bring about the end of the British resistance. An attack was mounted on the afternoon of the 25th and actually penetrated the British line. Somehow, the British managed to stop the Germans, whose attack lost momentum quickly due to fierce resistance and a huge amount of British artillery. The British called in artillery and finally airstrikes on the Germans to stall the attacks, whilst the Germans used Nebelwerfer's rocket artillery to pound the British into submission. A lot of the British prisoners taken in these critical days were shell-shocked by these strikes. Water and medical supplies were all but gone, and truces had to be called to evacuate the wounded to German hospitals in Arnhem. Thousands of British troops would end up as prisoners of war for this reason, perhaps as many as 6,000 at the end of the battle. Having hung on for 9 days, the powers were finished. On the evening of the 25th, a plan to withdraw across the Rhine was put in place, and the paratroopers crossed the Rhine in small boats throughout the night, under the cover of artillery fire. By the early morning of the 26th, the evacuation was over and the survivors of 1st Airborne met at Driel. Just 1,741 men of 1st Airborne had made it to Allied lines. The rest of the 10,000 that had dropped into Arnhem were either killed, wounded, or captured. In contrast, the Germans had lost around 3,000 men in the Arnhem sector. Another German attack went in on the 26th and found no resistance. The Germans were surprised. All they found were dead bodies and weapons. The British had gone. Yes, the field hospitals were full, but it dawned on them that the British had withdrawn overnight, and they had succeeded. They defeated the British. They'd won. And thus ended Operation Markegaard. It was day 10 now after the battle had begun, and at best you could probably call it a draw, but really it was a defeat for the Allies. The British had failed to cross the Rhine, their ultimate objective, and although the Allied troops had fought heroically throughout the battle, they'd tried to go a bridge too far. Total losses for both sides vary depending on which source you use. It's safe to assume that the German losses were somewhere around 6,000 to 9,000 men, although the actual number may never be known. Allied losses may be as high as 17,000, with about half of them, over 8,000, being 1st Airborne alone. But this series isn't over yet. We have one more main episode to go, and it's a biggie. The question we're going to ask, and I'll ask you guys now, is who was to blame for the failure of Operation Market Garden? Comment below and let me know. We've seen what happened, we've watched the battle unfold, now we get to decide who should take the blame for this defeat. We will find out next time. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing, bye for now. If you've watched all the episodes in this series so far, then you know what the plan was, you've seen what happened, and you know the outcome. Now we have to ask the question that has sparked controversy ever since. Who was to blame for the failure of Operation Market Garden? This was the biggest airborne operation of all time and the last major defeat of the British military. Historians have come up with a host of reasons for the failure of Market Garden, and we're going to delve into them today. If you've watched from the beginning of the series, you'll have seen the battle as it happened, but just so we're up to speed, let's quickly recap. The plan was to take all the bridges between Eindhoven and Arnhem using paratroopers and create a corridor for British tanks and infantry to drive up and over. We saw how the initial landings went well, and we've seen how most of the bridges were taken without much trouble. Only a small portion of the British powers got to Arnhem Bridge, but they held on until the fourth day of the operation. The Polish had dropped 5 days later and fought well to try and support the British on the opposite side of the Rhine. Somme Bridge had blown, but was rebuilt by the 101st and by 30 Corps, who made good the delay and raced towards Nijmegen. Here they fought a tough battle for Nijmegen City and the bridge, which, as a result of the determined and heroic effort of the soldiers of the American 82nd Airborne, saw the capture of that bridge. Sadly, despite the efforts of every Allied soldier up and down the corridor, the Germans had delayed them long enough to prevent them from taking the final bridge, Arnhem Bridge. As General Browning had supposedly said before the battle, it was a bridge too far. It may come as a shock then to hear that immediately after the battle, Sosabowski, the commander of the Polish forces, was relieved of command and blamed for the failure of Operation Market Garden. This may seem a little strange, and it was. Because of bad weather, the Polish had landed 5 days after the beginning of the operation, and despite a portion of their force jumping into the jaws of the enemy, they'd fought hard to support the British trapped at Oosterbeek. Why then was Sosabowski relieved? How could he be blamed for the failure of Operation Market Garden? The truth is that at the time, a scapegoat was needed, and the Polish were an easy target. Some have even suggested that the Poles were only included in the battle just in case it did go wrong. After the war, historians started to look deeper into the reasons for the failure of the operation, and nobody now thinks the Poles were to blame. But let's look at three of the main arguments for the failure of Operation Market Garden. The first argument is that it was a rotten plan, poorly executed, to quote Max Hastings. Now, there are a few variations to this popular and traditional argument, but the basic principle is this. The entire operation was a failure from its conception. It was an overambitious plan created in haste by a poor general, and the major mistakes that were made mainly by the British units in the battle. And it was the British that ultimately should take the blame for the failure of the entire operation. This argument makes clear that the ignored intelligence reports of the enemy tanks, the landing zones miles away from the bridge, not being able to land the entirety of the airborne divisions at once, faulty radios, and a host of bad decisions by commanders like Horrocks and Urquhart essentially proves that the operation was poorly executed. So 1st Airborne failed to get most of the troops to the Arnhem Bridge on day one. They were too eager to fight the Germans, then get to their objective. They were dropped too far away from the bridge. Their radios didn't work, so they became disorganized. 30 Corps wasn't hasty enough in driving up Hell's Highway, especially after getting across Nijmegen Bridge. They delayed when they could have pressed on towards Arnhem and may have gotten to Frostmen in time if they had only done this. And as General Gavin of the 82nd said, 30 Corps were 36 hours delayed before reaching Nijmegen, and as a result they were never going to get to the British at Arnhem in time. For this argument, blame is usually placed on one of the British generals. Montgomery, despised by many people for many different reasons, often receives criticism for coming up with this rotten plan. Urquhart receives a lot of criticism for accepting landing zones miles away from Arnhem Bridge, and for accompanying 3rd Battalion, slowing them down, and for getting trapped in a house with his 2nd-in-command Lathbury, and for not making it clear who was to take command of 1st Airborne if he and Lathbury were lost, etc, etc. So yeah, Urquhart had his fair share of the blame. Equally, it's also fair to say that Browning is the one who should have taken the blame, since he made plenty of mistakes as well. The most noteworthy of which is, you know, dismissing the intelligence reports of the German tanks in the Arnhem area. But Browning also takes criticism for taking vital transport aircraft from the British, and therefore weakening 1st Airborne on the first vital day. And let's not forget Horrocks, whose slow advance up Hell's Highway effectively doomed the operation. Proponents of this argument usually say 30 Corps took every opportunity to stop, rest, drink tea, and generally didn't perform so well. And once they got the tanks over the Nijmegen Bridge and the road ahead was clear, they stayed there and drank tea, despite an American paratrooper offering to go with them to Arnhem. So a few variations of who is to blame, but this argument is the one that has been ingrained in the minds of the majority of people when they think about Operation Market Garden. The massively popular film, A Bridge Too Far, probably did more than anything else to cement the popularity of this argument. A lot of the books that focus solely on the Arnhem part of the battle tend to agree with this argument too, because, as has been pointed out time and time again, the British made a lot of mistakes at Arnhem. So do you agree with this argument? Let us know in the comments. The second argument is that, wait for it, the Germans were the reason for the Allies' failure. Yes, surprisingly, some people think it wasn't as much as an Allied defeat as a German victory. Robert Kershaw, in his book It Never Snows in September, is adamant that the Germans outfought the Allies during Market Garden, despite having to rely on Eyes and Ears battalions and other unfit and reserve units. And when you look at the evidence, the Germans did a remarkable job with the little resources they had left. All they had was 2 depleted panzer divisions, not even at half strength, backed up by Kraftfahrzeug, which is actually part of 16th Panzer Grenadier Division. So you could make the claim that there were 2.5 panzer divisions at Arnhem. They also had Panzer Brigade 107, which successfully harassed the 101st Division, and the super successful 406th Division, that was more of a brigade than a division. But despite having a lack of men and equipment, the Germans were able to concentrate this ragtag force and throw them at the enemy and win this battle. Training their units to fight rather than march, improvisation and the creation of Kampfgruppen or battle groups, and the initiative of their leaders were all decisive factors that ultimately allowed the Germans to prevail. Kampfgruppe Spindler at Arnhem was decisive in stopping the rest of 1st Airborne reaching Frosted the Bridge. 10th SS Panzer Division fought at Nijmegen in a similar situation to Frost at Arnhem. They delayed 30 Corps at Nijmegen for 36 hours. It was the Germans who cut the corridor in the final days of the battle, and it was the Germans that came to the conclusion that it wasn't the British landing zones being too far away from Arnhem that was an issue. It was that a 2nd Airborne Division had not dropped into the area west of Arnhem. This argument raises the question, was it more of an Allied defeat or a German victory? If you support this argument, let us know. And the final argument makes the case that the battle was lost, not at its inception, not at its planning, not even by the Germans, sort of, but by the decision not to capture the Nijmegen Bridge on day one. This newer argument makes the case that the original Market Garden plan was thrown out as soon as General Gavin of the 82nd made the decision to deprioritize the capture of the Nijmegen Bridge and focus his division on the Groesbeek Heights. Without the capture of Nijmegen Bridge, there was no way 30 Corps could get to Arnhem in time. Supporters of this argument also make the case that 30 Corps wasn't delayed before they reached Nijmegen, they were delayed 36 hours at Nijmegen. They also point out that it was Gavin who later claimed 30 Corps was 36 hours behind schedule before reaching Nijmegen Bridge. So basically, because Nijmegen Bridge wasn't taken on day one, the Germans were able to block the road to Arnhem and therefore the operation was doomed. It wasn't that 30 Corps was too slow, as the first argument suggests, but that they suffered too much of a critical delay at Nijmegen. The whole point of the operation was to lay an airborne carpet for the tanks to roll over, and the bridges were therefore the priority of the operation. Market Garden failed because one of those bridges was ignored for a few hours after the initial landings, allowing the Germans to secure it. Gavin certainly comes under flak by supporters of this argument, since he made the original decision to deprioritize Nijmegen Bridge, but blame also goes to General Browning, commander of the whole airborne part of the plan, since his hand was in that decision too. When asked who made the decision to prioritize the Groesbeek Heights rather than the bridge at Nijmegen, General Gavin's response was, "This decision was made by myself and approved by my corps commander." As a result, it's fair to place the blame on General Gavin of the 82nd Airborne and his superior, British General Frederick Browning. So there is a basic overview of the three main arguments for the failure of Operation Market Garden. Keep asking it, but which one do you agree with? Now, having seen the battle unfold, it's hard not to come to the conclusion that the operation was lost at Nijmegen. Gavin and Browning failed to take a bridge, which was the one thing they had to do. The objective of the whole operation was to take the bridges, and they simply didn't do it. And whilst you could say it was the Germans who held the Nijmegen Bridge for so long, it was only because Gavin didn't send troops to take it until the early evening of the first day, by which point it was too late anyway. It's almost as if it was an afterthought. There is this fact floating around that 30 Corps was 36 hours behind schedule by the time they reached Nijmegen Bridge, but this is actually something Gavin said after the battle to bend the truth. 30 Corps was at Nijmegen at the beginning of day 3 of the operation. So 42 hours after the beginning of the operation, since it started in the afternoon, they couldn't have been 36 hours behind schedule. They'd gone 50 miles out of the 58, and they got into Nijmegen with time to spare. Unfortunately, not enough time to spare to fight the 10th SS Panzer Division, but if Nijmegen Bridge had been taken by the 82nd, it's likely they could have reached Arnhem by the end of day 3. Because the 82nd hadn't taken Nijmegen Bridge, it took 30 Corps and the bravery of the 82nd troopers paddling across the Waal another 36 hours to get across the bridge. Nijmegen cost 30 Corps a day and a half, and as a result, caused Frost troops to be overwhelmed, caused 1st Airborne more casualties, and caused the failure of the entire operation. British troops at Arnhem were not relieved, and if they had been on day 3 or even on day 4, it's reasonable to assume that 30 Corps could have been across the Rhine. So why didn't they take Nijmegen Bridge on day 1? Now, the obvious problem is that most of the 82nd Airborne had been ordered to guard the Groesbeek Heights. Now, you could say yes, they needed the heights because it was their landing zone. But the issue isn't that they guarded the landing zones, the issue is that they guarded the landing zone with as many troops as they did, and also flew in artillery to pound the 1,000 tanks in the Reichswald, rather than take extra troops that could go towards Nijmegen. And Warren, who in the end sent 1st Battalion towards the bridge, wasn't told to take Nijmegen Bridge until the evening of the first day. There is a debate still ongoing as to whether Warren was issued pre-drop orders to take Nijmegen Bridge or not. He insists that he wasn't until around 7 or 8 PM on day 1. Prior to this, he had been ordered to dig in at the Groesbeek Heights, which he'd done. The blame therefore rests on General Gavin for not sending anyone towards Nijmegen. Because Gavin feared an attack from the 1,000 German tanks that were meant to be hiding in the Reichswald, he placed priority on taking the Groesbeek Heights to protect his flank against attack. Except there weren't 1,000 tanks in the Reichswald. In fact, there is no evidence that anyone other than Gavin thought there were any tanks in the Reichswald at all. The German 406th Division that did move out on day 2 of the operation could barely be called a brigade, as I said before. And the first time any German force worth mentioning came out of the Reichswald, moved out on day 4. At that point, the battle should have been over anyway. Gavin made the initial decision not to take Nijmegen Bridge. This was a poor idea, and Browning, as Gavin's superior, should have questioned Gavin's decision to take the Grosbeak Heights. Browning should have ordered Gavin to make Nijmegen Bridge the priority once again. He didn't do that. Why? Because he wanted to be on the ground to command the operation from the front, and he wanted the glory of leading a successful operation from the ground. And also setting up his headquarters on the Grosbeak Heights would allow him to direct the battle in theory. In practice though, Browning did next to nothing practical when he was actually on the ground. So rather than telling Gavin to change his plans, he reinforced them, which ultimately proved to be a disastrous decision. Browning also makes several other disastrous decisions, like dismissing the intelligence reports about enemy tanks. So if you come to the conclusion that it was Browning's fault, you can certainly argue that case. But ultimately, the failure of the operation wasn't Nijmegen. And when asking who was to blame for the failure of Operation Market Garden, you have to blame the person who changed the plan to suit their wants. And the evidence here points to General Gavin. The thing is, Gavin knew his head was likely to roll. To quote Max Hastings in his book Armageddon, Gavin of the US 82nd urged that the US Army should review its policy of ruthlessly relieving formation commanders who failed in a single battle. He argued it might be wiser to allow general officers to gain experience and to enjoy at least a second chance. Because he'd messed up. He was urging this because he was responsible for the failure of Operation Market Garden. Basically, he was begging to keep his job. I'm going to recite a lengthy but relevant quote from John Frost. By far, the worst mistake was the lack of priority given to the capture of Nijmegen Bridge. The whole essence of the plan was to lay an airborne carpet across the obstacles in southern Holland so that the army could motor through. Yet the capture of this, perhaps the biggest and most vital bridge, in that its destruction would have sounded the death knell of the troops committed at Arnhem, was not accorded priority. The capture of this bridge would have been a walkover on D-Day, yet the American 82nd Airborne Division could spare only one battalion, as they must at all costs secure a feature called the Grosbeak Heights, where, incidentally, the HQ of Airborne Corps was to be sited. It was thought that the retention of this feature would prevent the debouchement of German armour from the Reichswald in Germany. This armour was there by courtesy of rumour only, and its presence was not confirmed by the underground. In fact, as a feature, it is by no means dominating, and its retention or otherwise had absolutely no bearing on what happened at Nijmegen Bridge. Thus, who was to blame for the failure of Operation Market Garden? Gavin. But I'm certain some of you will disagree, which is why I told you right at the beginning that this was a controversial battle. The myths surrounding Market Garden have been burned into history. I hope we've made a dent in those myths today. Of course, history does not stand still. Tomorrow, new evidence or a new theory could come along and sweep away the conclusions we make today. But until then, I'd like to hear who or what you guys think is ultimately responsible for the failure of Operation Market Garden. Do you agree with the conclusions of this documentary? Hopefully you don't, because that's what's great about history. It's not just about facts and figures, it's about arguing. And we all like a good moan. This certainly won't be the last documentary I make, so make sure you subscribe to be notified of more. I hope this has been entertaining and enlightening. Thanks for watching, thanks for subscribing. Bye for now.